everybody. I'm Levi Littvay from the Central European University, and I have a very, very, very special guest, Takis Pappas, who I know because he's now a researcher at the University of Helsinki in Finland, but he has been visiting at the Central European University several times, so we got to hang out. Say hi, Takis.
Hi there. Hi, Levi. I like the decoration behind you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So people are not demanding the pineapple. This has been a central.
No, I was looking at the guitars.
At the guitars. Okay.
Really wow, fascinating.
That's the hobby right now. So this is awesome. I've been wanting to get Takis on here, and you just posted something on your blog and on Twitter, which is sort of a typology of how do we know that a political party is populist. And when I saw that, I was like, yes, this is the opportunity to get you on here, because it's completely different than what like team populism stands behind, the ideational definition. So let's talk about it. This is going to be an awesome opportunity, because you know, this is, you know, Takis and I always argue about these things, and I'm just so happy that we can do it on camera right now. So you want to introduce what was the idea behind this? Where did this come from, this poster?
This comes from, it builds on years of work. I have been working on populism and democracy for about a dozen years now. So I decided at a certain point that I have to kind of popularize some ideas that I've written about in books, academic articles, etc. This is the stuff that only a few people can read, especially in universities and academia. So I thought of kind of popularizing some of those or some of that thinking. So I began working on a kind of visuals, graphics, infographics. I've produced a number of them. So I produced one on populism versus nativism, another one on charismatic leadership and populism, a third one on how to classify political parties in Europe and how to locate populist parties in Europe in the last 30 years. One can find those in my blog. And the final, the last one that came out more recently, is this typology of political parties and how to spot. The idea was to spot political parties within the universe of political parties. Okay, so I thought that we talk theoretically most of the time, but we cannot put our fingers on the things we study, we examine. So my thing was, I mean, this is the extension of the concept, right? I mean, we talk about democracy, we talk about populism, we talk about this or that, but what are the units, what are the things we're referring to when we use a certain concept? So the real challenge here was for me, and is for everybody, I guess, to distinguish those units. I mean, to say, which parties or which political systems or who leaders are populists and who are not. So I thought of thinking, I mean, I thought globally at a universal kind of perspective. So I came up with a very simple classification, taxonomy of political parties in which I place my populist parties. So in that scheme, you see the names of party types, but then you can put your own very specific parties, what you have in mind, what you know about, what you have studied on that taxonomy, okay? And it works very neatly, actually, and because there are not many gaps. Of course, there are gray areas between the areas, as always, but the categories are very, very clear. And you get this tree, this taxonomic tree, and then you get the definitions underneath. Those are minimal definitions. I provide 13 definitions of all main party types, and they do not overlap too much. So to explain the logic here a bit more, what I have done here is a taxonomic exercise. In a sense, I mean, when we talk, let me give you an example. I mean, when we talk about animals, for example, we need to make sense of them, right? I mean, we have all animals. That is the universe of animals. So then how do we divide them? How do we make sense of them? We may proceed with a taxonomy of dividing them into vertebrates and invertebrates, for example. Okay, so we have a second level of analysis. Then we go further down and we divide the vertebrates, say, into fish, birds, reptiles, amphibians, and mammals, right? Mm-hmm. So we are at the third level of analysis, which makes things much more concrete there. Now, if we focus on the mammals, which we may define in any way, for example, I mean, a good definition of mammals is, you know, animals that make milk for their young and have hair, okay? Mm-hmm. Then we go even further down and distinguish mammals into carnivorous or and herbivorous, or into logical animals, where we belong, mm-hmm. okay, men and women, humans, and illogical animals, etc., etc. So I've done this kind of stuff. I mean, this is, you know, the Aristotelian kind of mode of analysis, per genum et differentiam. This is how it is called in technical kind of language. So you take the genus, which is animals, or all political parties, or food. Say food. I mean, you have foods, and then you have meat, you have fish, you have vegetables, and then you go all the way down, right? Mm-hmm. So I did this exercise with political parties. So I begin with the genus level is all political parties on Earth, on the globe. I mean, historically, yes. geographically, any political party. Then I define, I divide them into two categories. So my first species level is mm-hmm. democratic versus non-democratic parties. Mm-hmm. And then I divide each of those categories into sub-sub-species.
So let me ask you this. So the first decision we need to make when we want to decide if a party is populist or not populist according to the taxonomy is, are they democratic or are they non-democratic, right? Ah. Does that sound right?
Ha. That is a very interesting question that leads us to a very interesting discussion or...
Okay.
Which is, I mean, why do we study populist parties? I mean, mm-hmm. this is the definition I always, you know, ask myself and to others sometimes. And I do not get very interesting, you know, answers. I mean, we do not study parties just to give a definition of them, right? Who cares about how we define them? I mean... A table mm-hmm. is a table, unless one shows you a desk and says, well, is that a table or a desk? So there you need the definition, right? Now, why do we care about populism? We care about populism, in my view, and in my mind, and in my interests, because it affects the democracies in which I live in. I mean, I've lived in Hungary, I come from Greece, I've lived in a number of countries, for large periods of times. All of those countries have been democratic, but their democracies have not been of the same kind. So mm-hmm. the Hungarian democracy is quite different than the democracy in France or the democracy in Belgium, where I live currently.
Yes.
Okay, so what makes a difference is that Hungarian democracy has an element that is not very vivid in France or Belgium, and that is illiberalism. So this changes the equation, and this changes the way I live my life in Hungary and the way I live my life in France or Belgium or Greece, mm-hmm. right? So we study populism because I think that there are three reasons that we study populism. One is that it affects our lives, okay? It is, and this in a dangerous way sometimes. I mean, believe me, I mean, I come from Greece and I've been through a very, very long crisis that was due to years of populism in my little country. And perhaps you have a similar experience from your country.
So, it does sound familiar.
And then I suppose that Americans in recent years have had the same experience in their countries, right? Mm-hmm. So we study populism because it relates to democracy and it relates to the future of you know, liberal democracy, which liberal democracy is a very recent thing. I mean, liberal democracy is a creation of the victorious forces of the Second World War. I mean, mm-hmm. there was not this kind of liberalism before 1945, right? Mm-hmm. So what you see is that, and then populism is a very recent phenomenon, because if you look at Europe, for example, in previous decades, in the late 40s, mm-hmm. the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, there was not any populist party around. And then yeah. after the 80s, okay, and you may begin thinking which was the first country in Europe that had a populist party in power. I may answer that later, as you think. Until that time, you did not have any populist parties. And from the 1980s, I would say, you have a proliferation of populists in countries like Italy, Hungary, Poland, etc., etc. So it is a new phenomenon, and this is surprising as such, okay? And it affects democracy. And there is a third characteristic that, you know, I find very intriguing, and when it comes to populism. Populism thrives on both left and right in the same mm-hmm. way. I mean, if you look at its characteristics, are very, very, very similar. Not only that, left and right populism tend to collide, to coalesce, to make alliances. We saw that yeah. in Greece, okay? Yeah. We may see that in France next year in the elections. So there's a circuit of voters who go, who move, you know, between left and right populist parties. Mm-hmm. So it is for those reasons that populism is such an important and such an intriguing and fascinating phenomenon. And this is how I started thinking about populism as a Greek who, you know, was raised, who grew up in a populist, you know, state. And this is how I came up with this, you know, little infographic. Because you have to associate populism with, you know, democracy, and then you have to distinguish it from other types of democracy or non-democracy. Because you know what? Populism is somewhere between democracy and non-democracy. So populism mm-hmm. is a very, very strong authoritarian impulse. We saw that in Hungary. We saw yep. that in Venezuela. Okay. Yep. We saw that in the United States with the Capitol Hill. For example. Mm-hmm. So populism may revert back to liberal democracy. We have not seen that many times. Perhaps Greece is a case here, but it may move towards autocracy, towards authoritarianism. Yes. So, and this makes it very dangerous, okay? Mm-hmm.
So let's go through the taxonomy because I mean, you said it's tree-like, so we just have to make very simple binary decisions about parties to be able to classify them. And the first classification is, are they democratic or non-democratic? And here I believe, but correct me if I'm wrong, you're talking about elections. Are they supporting electoral democracy, right?
Yeah, so
this is the first decision in the taxonomy, right?
I'm talking about a relatively free and relatively fair elections. Yes. I mean, elections are never fair. There is no state with fair elections, absolutely fair elections, because you have so many cleavages, so many divisions in society, so many interests, okay? So I'm happy when elections are free, every party can participate in elections, mm-hmm. no parties are banned, and relatively fair. So the rules mm-hmm. of the game, okay? Mm-hmm. That is democratic, that is a democracy. Okay, now, mm-hmm. when you have parties that are excluded from elections, then you do not have a democracy. And then you have a liberal democracy when elections mm-hmm. take place under a liberal constitution, under the rule of law, and where mm-hmm. the rights of all minorities are respected. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that is the idea.
Yeah, and under liberal democracy, I see you've listed potential nativist parties that protect liberal democracy, where there are strong minority protections, and nationalist parties, potentially regionalist parties, secessionist parties. So all of these parties, as long as they support liberal democracy and the protections of the political and ethnic and et cetera minorities, you would say they are not populist. So if a party is democratic, from an electoral point of view, and support liberal democratic protections, they are not populist according to this taxonomy. Does that sound right?
There is a very interesting empirical fact. If you go out and examine the cases one by one, you will see that populist parties, when they come into power, the first thing they do is that they change, or try to change at least, sometimes, most of the times they succeed, sometimes, a few times they have failed, like in Berlusconi's Italy, for example. Mm-hmm. So the first thing they try to do is to change the constitution, okay? Mm-hmm. To modify the constitution and have an illiberal constitution. I mean, Hungary is a very typical case. Yes. Kaczynski in Poland is a very typical case. We have seen that in Argentina, Venezuela, et cetera, et cetera. Trump would be very happy to do that if he could. The nativist or nationalist parties, et cetera, they abide by the rules of the existing mm-hmm. constitution, the liberal constitution. That is mm-hmm. the defining criterion here. Do they accept the constitution? Do they accept liberalism or not? They do. So as long as they accept, as long as they do not push for the banning of other parties from elections, and as long as they accept the liberal constitution, we have to, we like them or not, okay, those parties, mm-hmm. we have to include them in the category of liberal parties. We have to be consistent with our definitions mm-hmm. and our classifications.
Yeah.
So, for example, Marine Le Pen's party is a nativist party in the sense that it does not want to change the constitution. They don't want any longer to take, you know, France out of the European Union. So France stays in the European Union. But on the other hand, they want to develop a polity in which the liberal rights will be reserved for the native born. So there mm-hmm. will be a discrimination against. Now, is that liberal or not? Now, that is a big discussion, of course.
Yes.
I understand that. Of course. Of course. That is a big, big discussion there. Okay? And then do the nativist parties, are the nativist parties prepared to grant equal rights to the existing minorities? Are they going to ban, to put, you know, more border controls for incoming minorities in the future, et cetera, et cetera? So those are big discussions. But as long as those parties accept the existing liberal constitutions and they do not want to change them, we cannot say that those are illiberal parties, okay? Mm-hmm. Because my definition of populism is that populist parties have only two characteristics, and that's that they are democratic parties. They mm-hmm. participate in free elections and they support a democratic state, a democratic political system, but they are illiberal. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, but I think this is a very important distinction. And I think on this one, we very much agree, is that there can be radical right parties that are not populist.
Give me examples. I mean, let's talk about examples.
Okay, so I know Kasmuda would not agree with me, but
definitely he doesn't agree with me. So don't worry about it.
Yeah, but Jobbik historically has, or even today, has been one of these parties. I mean,
take Jobbik. That's a good example. This is why I like talking on the basis of examples. Now, in my classification tree, Jobbik, first of all, we have to always have into our minds very, very, you know, strongly the idea that parties change positions over time, right? So parties are like, you know, moving targets. You cannot, mm-hmm. you do classify them today, but tomorrow they may have changed mm-hmm. a position, okay, their discourse, their policy ideas, et cetera, et cetera. And you have to put them in another cluster, in another, you know, pigeonhole, right? So Jobbik is one of those parties. So Jobbik, in the beginning, it was an anti-democratic party. They participated in elections. So I have them as partaking elections parties. And then it moves, okay, towards a liberal or pseudo-liberal, if you like, direction. So as long as they abide by the constitution and oppose Fidesz, they are liberal or pseudo-liberal. I mean, I have to put them in that direction. So they may be very conservative, okay? So mind you, all of my categories include both left and right. So in yes, all of yes, my of in all of my cases, you find left and right. So that is in there. So that is, but that is a secondary characteristic, right? Mm-hmm. Now, take as another example, Fidesz. So Fidesz mm-hmm. begins its political life as a liberal party. Then yes. it moves to a populist, to the populist bubble, okay? Yes. Becomes democratic anti-liberal. And today, it seems to be moving towards a non-democratic authoritarian direction. Yes. Let's see what happens with the elections you have next year in Hungary, yeah. okay?
Well,
Let's see how it behaves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jobbik is not a problem here because it moves mm-hmm. from position to position over time. Mm-hmm. And
we probably should talk through the other side of the taxonomy. So we talked through democratic parties. We haven't talked through the non-democratic parties. But let's do that quickly because I mean Jobbik already came up in this context. So if a party is non-democratic, it does not support electoral democracy, then it's automatically, it cannot be populist. So that's what your taxonomy says. And you have parties here that do not participate in elections at all because they're state parties. And there are parties here that do partake in elections, but they don't support the institution of elections, right? And none of these are populists.
No, because non-democracy is a higher category than populist. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
so if exactly. you classify them as non-democratic parties, so take, for example, I mean, Hitler's, the Nazi party. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. it doesn't make any sense to say that it was a populist party or, you know, Stalin's, yeah. you know. Those were, maybe you know, on. Of course. But it doesn't make sense because those were Nazis primarily. And then, you know, when it comes to, let me explain that because that is very mm-hmm. interesting.
Okay.
We do not know much about it because in Europe, we do not have that many non-democratic parties, right? So non-democratic parties globally, we're talking globally, right? Are those parties that either are in opposition and they participate in a parliamentary system and they compete elections and their only goal is to undermine parliamentary democracy, like Golden Dawn in Greece. I mean, that is a very, very characteristic party.
I can imagine or the Islamist parties.
You don't have those in Europe. Right?
Yeah,
I will come to this in a moment. Okay. So in Europe, you do not have that. I mean, you have Jobbik, for example. Jobbik was mm-hmm. one such party. So when they were in their authoritarian version. So they mm-hmm. were a non-democratic party, or if you like, I mean, the Front National under Le Pen, under, you know, the father mm-hmm. Le Pen. I mean, that was a racist, non-democratic party in my classification. They did take part in elections, okay? But they wanted to undermine the parliamentary democratic system and the liberal system, of course. Now, if you take the world, if you look at the world more globally, you see many non-democratic parties that are in power in mm-hmm. many parts of the world, in Africa, in Asia, etc., etc. Now, those parties control the state. And the characteristic of those parties is that it is very difficult to overthrow them, right?
Yeah.
Now, they come into variants. So you have the authoritarian variant, that is, you know, Putin, Erdogan, etc. They control the state, they organize elections, but they always win, okay?
Yeah.
Then we have totalitarian parties, those that control the totality of the polity and the citizens who live. I mean, that was, you know, Mao's party in China, for example, or, you know, Stalin's, you know, or totalitarianism in the Soviet Union. And then you have this kind that, you know, Weber has coined the term sultanistic, and then my mentor Juan Linz used it many times, sultanistic, where you have totalitarian regimes in which only one leader and his clan, his family, control the state. That is North Korea, for example, okay, mm-hmm. or Libya under Gaddafi, or Saudi yes. Arabia, etc. You have many cases like that, okay? Mm-hmm. Ceausescu, for example. It was a sultanistic state, okay? And so that is a very simple distinction that I think helps you classify any type of political party, okay, mm-hmm. and have that in one page, in one, you know, little graphic, and mm-hmm. it is there.
Yeah, and it's clear that you know, if there's a question, you say these are not black and white necessarily, but no. If there's a question, you know exactly what to debate. You know what distinction to debate and to decide if this party is closer to this side or that side. So in this sense, it's quite clear. I wanted to ask you. So go ahead.
Not only that. Let me stay here for a moment. This is. It is not only that you can name the parties. It is theoretically very rich. This image gives you lots of theoretical cues, if you like, because mm-hmm. you will see from the image, for example, if you look at that visually, you will see that that populist parties are located between non-democratic parties on one hand and nativist and nationalist parties on the other hand. So if it comes to real life politics, and if you have those parties in a political system in a country, say, okay, be that Hungary, Finland, or Greece, how do those parties compete in elections? What happens? Different combinations give you different electoral dynamics and produce different governments, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah. It is theoretically very, you know, pregnant thing, very ripe. And you can make a lot of, produce new theories, new thinking about that, mm-hmm. okay? So what happens, yeah. for example, I mean, one finding is that one of my findings is that nativist parties thrive and flourish in countries with fragmented party systems, okay, and very advanced societies in Western and mm-hmm. Northern Europe. You do not see them in other places. So you see them only in very advanced, socially, economically, and politically advanced nations where you have fragmented party systems, therefore, lots of combinations for producing governments in which mm-hmm. nativist parties can exercise an intimidation potential in those systems. Mm-hmm. So you do not have nativism in the South, for example, okay? Well, Salvini is just an example, but this is not a very pure mm-hmm. case of nativism, I think. So, yeah.
Yeah, Salvini almost maybe even fits secessionist, right?
Well, it was, I mean, Lega, don't forget, I mean, Lega of Northern League is another case, very interesting case that moves places. So it was mm-hmm. a regionalist party in the beginning, and today it is, I think it is a nativist party, but it might move again, okay? Mm-hmm. And then secessionist, I mean, yeah, I mean, if you talk about Padania, et cetera, it was probably a secessionist party as well. I mean, secessionist, the Scottish National mm-hmm. Party yeah. belongs here. Okay.
Yeah,
the parties in Catalonia, for example, they belong mm-hmm. here. And then you yeah. can go one level below, which is not in this typology. You can have irredentist secessionist mm-hmm. parties. For example, yes. the Basques. Okay.
Yeah.
So they want to create a part not only to secede from Madrid, okay, but also to have a party with Spanish Basque and French Basque. Populations. So that's yeah. another. So you can go even further down, right?
Of course. But I mean, the you wouldn't want to because the
no, I, you don't I need to. I mean,
especially to get to populists for sure. So okay, so let me ask you this, because I mean, you start this whole infographic with the critique that while populism remains ill-defined and poorly defined, we're gonna have trouble. So what? Do you know, I come from the tradition of the ideational definition, which looks at the discourse, the rhetoric, the style, from the perspective of populism needs to be people-centric and anti-elitist, the Kasmuda definition, in kind of a polarizing way. This is usually applied to politicians and not parties, though it certainly could be applied to parties as well. Where do you see the relative advantages and potential disadvantages of your approach and the relationship to the other classification?
Let me ask you something. I mean, I have a question which I've never asked actually. Why is that approach called ideational, since it is based on the idea of an ideology? Why it is not called ideological approach? Is there an answer to that?
I have no idea. No, that's a good question. I always just took it as a synonym, but it is ideological. I think the goal is to make a distinction that in the core of political science, ideology is based on left-right and liberal-conservative. And then, you know, if you're talking typologies, we can dig deeper. I think it wanted to make a distinction that that it is based on this quote-unquote thin ideology that cannot exist on its own, but rather has to attach itself to a more classical ideology. I think maybe that is where the distinction comes from, is they didn't want to produce confusion with the traditional ideologies, that this is just an addition or another dimension of the ideology, though it certainly could be based on how most people have been thinking about it. Though I think it's fair to say that these people who study ideational populism would agree that that populism is less important than ideology, because it cannot exist without. Does that make sense?
Well, it creates some confusion to me, to tell you the truth. I'm kind of you know picky with terms. I mean, I like minimal definition. This is not a minimal definition, actually, that you are using, because you said so many words already. So a minimal definition is one that retains only the core characteristics of the thing we have to examine and leaves outside all secondary or accompanying criteria or characteristics or properties. So in my definition, for example, I have just two words, democratic liberalism, and I need two properties to come together. That is as minimal as it takes. Now, when we come to the ideational definition, the definition, correct me if I'm wrong, to summarize, to reference in my mind, in that definition, populism is an ideology which presents the people as a morally good force, and contrast them to a corrupt elite. Is that right?
Yes. Yes.
Right.
Yes. That's the definition.
But that is absolutely, I mean, I abide by this idea. I mean, I believe that, yes. I mean, following the principle that, you know, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, the more higher up you go in the social hierarchy, the more the likelihood of, you know, having corrupt people. So the elites are by definition more corrupt, or are expected to be more corrupt than the normal people. So what's bad about that? I mean, this is, you know, the art of stating the obvious. I believe in that. Am I a populist? No. What I want to say is that this definition is based on it is very obvious what is happening there. Yes, but so it is an approach. It's not a theory, though. So I accept that. Of course, I mean, when I say illiberalism, I mean, that is, I mean, I accept that you have different discourses, different strategies, different organizations, perhaps, different leadership styles, etc., all of that. And there are many approaches, and that is fine with me, the ideational or ideological approach. I accept that. But this does not lead me to a theory. That is my problem. I mean, when you want to theorize about something, you have to have a basic question. What is the question here? I mean, my question, as I said earlier, is how does populism affect the democracy in which I live, my children live in, and how it affects my life? So I want to understand that. I want to understand that, you know, in this balance between liberalism and illiberalism, where do I stand? What does it do to my life and my family's life and my friends, etc., etc.? Mm-hmm. So if we say that populism is something that, you know, represents the people as morally, you know, better than the elites. Where does it take us? I mean, but this is, you know, the meaning of democracy, and all oppositions in all democracies will tell you that. I mean, I cannot think of any opposition in any country at any time that will not tell you that the government is kind of corrupt and we're better than them, and let us, you know, defeat them in elections and we will do things better. So that's fine, that is very obvious though, but this is not a theory because there is not a basic question there. Secondly, I do not see propositions. The only propositions I can see there is that, you know, this leader uses the term, you know, people 1,000 times, and the other leader uses that 3,000 times during the election course. And finally, the third thing that is missing here, in my opinion, is that how can we make predictions, and what kind of predictions can we make with this theory? How can we verify and how can we falsify? Mm-hmm. Verify what? That, you know, all leaders use this this discourse? Thank you very much. Yes, they do. That is quite evident. That mm-hmm. I mean, what do we expect them to do? To say that, you know, those in power are not worse than us, that are better or are the same good as us, the opposition? So we need a theory, and we need a theory actually that will be useful, will address the whys we study populism and why do we study populism now, okay? And then it will be able to make propositions, theoretical propositions that will be verified or falsified by empirical evidence. Mm-hmm. And I'm very heavy on empirical evidence, as you know. Yeah. I mean, in my work, I go to the cases and examine them in historical depth and very, very widely and broadly. I look at a number of factors. I look at leadership. I look at discourse, of course. I look at political competition patterns. And I'm trying to see how this modern illiberalism grows in our societies and in our political systems. One thing that you will notice is that we do not talk that much about left and right in politics in Europe or, you know, in other places in the world. Why? Because we talk a lot about illiberalism versus liberalism.
Yeah. Yeah, and that I think this is certainly the case with ideational. Yeah.
That is the dimension that has come to cover the old, or push away, in a sense, the old dimension of left versus right.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So the crucial thing is how our liberal societies will remain liberal, and what kind of liberalism is that going to be? Is that going to be the liberalism of the nativist parties, or the liberalism of the non-nativist parties, or it will be the liberalism of the Orbans and Kaczynskis and Trumps of this world? So I'm trying to answer to those questions, which are not simple questions, okay? Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to predict. So it is, I have a very predictive so my mind works in a way that tries to predict anyways. And you know, the thing here is to see how liberalism can sustain its morality, its own morality, okay? Mm-hmm. Or it will be undermined by another type of liberalism for the natives, okay, in Europe or in other places in the world. In America, for example, you may see a wave of nativism. Do you know that? For example, I mean, many people talk in America and they say that, you know, populism comes from the Omaha platform in the late 19th century, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of Dennis Kearley, for example? Do you know who he was? No, you don't. No one knows about Dennis Kearley. Dennis Kearley was a contemporary of the Omaha platform and the Populist Party, you know, guys. He was a first generation Irishman who came to San Francisco in the late 19th century, and he led a movement against the Chinese immigrants. So he was the first nativist in the United States. So nativism in the United States is much, much earlier, or not much, but earlier than populism, 19th century populism. And that was very, very strong. I mean, what Trump was telling us a few years ago was said by Dennis Kirley back in the 1870s or 80s, I think. And he created a movement, a mass movement against the Chinese workers, okay? That was a nativist movement. So you may see phenomena like that a lot, especially in Europe, and we have to make sense of them. And it is difficult for me to compare, for example, I mean, the nativism of in Finland, for example, with populism in Hungary. I mean, those are two different things.
Two entirely different things.
And they affect the societies in quite different ways. So, and you end up in Hungary with a liberal constitution, whereas the Finns are very happy with their very liberal constitution, and they may have occasionally the True Finns Party, or the Finns Party as they're called today, in some coalition government where everybody participates.
I mean, I was thinking when you put up this typology, I was thinking about, you know, how coming at it from the ideational perspective, how I see this. And certainly one of the problems with the ideational perspective, and I don't think the critique that, well, everybody criticizes the government. Yeah, that's true. But do they do it in a way that delegitimizes their existence, their actions, their in the name of the people? I think that's the important distinction there. But one of the conclusions or one of the outcomes of ideational populism is certainly this, what you lay out, is liberal democracy erodes. And I was trying to think of like populists in power that, or non-populists in power, let's say, non-ideational populists in power that, can I even think of like an illiberal party that is not ideationally populist? Like maybe Dukanovic in Montenegro, but that's the only thing I can, that's the only party I could think of. So I actually do see a lot of overlap here, certainly. And I understand the appeal of where you're coming from. I just too invested in the ideational approach to kind of let it go.
I think let me tell you two things here. I mean, the first is that, for one thing, everybody now, I mean, we understand that or not, and I understand that very, very well, because I follow the literature and I still work on populism. I write fresh things. I'm working on a book, etc. So everybody accepts that populism is about democracy and liberalism. It is everywhere now. I mean, a few years ago when I began, you know, when I introduced this definition in 2012, okay, and then it was an article that I wrote about Hungary. I was comparing Hungary with Greece, and the article came out in 2013. That was 1 year before Orban took up the term and popularized that. So everybody today talks about, I mean, when we talk about populism, we talk consciously or not about democracy and liberal democracy. Yes. The second thing I wanted to tell you is that if I were in your perspective or your approach, if I took your approach, I would try to, and now I will challenge you. I would try to build a new typological tree, and I would begin with frames. So the genus, the overall genus would be different symbolic frames. And I would make a symbolic frame for liberal parties, a symbolic frame for, you know, populist parties, whatever you want to call them, et cetera, et cetera. And I would, you know, and nationalist parties. And I would do that because
your typology.
You talk about frames. You talk about how reality is represented. Actually, your approach is about how various parties represent reality. So to say that, you know, the people are morally good always, et cetera, and they fight against, you know, a corrupt elite. That is a way of representing reality. That is a frame. Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah.
Bro, this is what you're talking about. You're not talking about, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm giving you ideas.
Yeah, definitely. But I think the big difference in our thinking about this is you're coming at this from kind of a Sartorian perspective of classification. We need to classify.
Sartorian comes from an Aristotelian perspective. So
yeah, of course. So you're coming at an Aristotelian.
As a Southern European, I mean, I have to follow my compatriot Aristotle. And Sartori, I met Sartori.
It's not a critique.
Yeah. No. I adore Sartori, by the way. Yeah, I mean, I consider myself, I think that he was, you know, he was one of the mentors in my life. And as a matter of fact, I dedicated half of my dedication in my last book was to Sartori. So nice. I want to get inspiration when I write and, you know, I'm at dead ends. I just, you know, go back to Sartori and I read Sartori. Of course, it is not a critique. I mean, I take that as...
No. I mean, it's not a critique. But
Sartori is a fantastic scholar.
Yeah.
I mean, think about it.
Well, absolutely. But I come from the tradition of measurement that is very continuous. So we need degrees. We need to measure degrees. And we don't have to do classification. And also, one of the reasons why the ideational definition was very appealing to me personally, and that's what kind of sucked me into the whole study of populism, was our ability to start looking at it from a public opinion point of view. So I actually wonder, like, is your classification definable from a public opinion perspective? I think it is. I'll give you my answer. I think it is.
Okay. But... Again, let me give you two answers. To what you told me right now, Sartori would give you a very concise, brief answer to which I subscribe. He will tell you, you first define and then you measure.
Yes, so, of course. That's
qualification comes not prior to qualification, but follows qualification. So that's one thing. The second thing is that, yes, absolutely. I mean, I can operationalize my terms very, very well. I mean, I've done that in my book, actually. But I think that my terms are highly and fully operationalizable. Fully operationalizable, as it were.
I agree with you. I actually agree with you.
So, and again, I mean, you see, I use just very few criteria, very few properties. Democracy. Mm-hmm. I have actually two pairs. One is liberalism. One is democracy versus non-democracy, and the second is liberalism versus liberalism. Mm-hmm. That's all. From that, you create a number of combinations, and then you have the whole. You have the entirety of the picture. And that is the magic here, the simplicity of this scheme here, because I use very, very few properties, very, very few criteria. Actually, it is only two or four, if you like, democracy, liberalism, non-democracy, illiberalism, non-liberalism. And you can operationalize and you can give numbers to those, you can attach numbers to those properties very, very well, actually. I would love to see that. I mean, I would love to see some quant person like you or your colleagues try their hands.
Maybe we should do that together one of these days. There's an opportunity for collaboration. All right, let me give you one last question. So there are those people, and I am sure to some extent, we both agree with this, who say that populism has gotten into such a mess already with the definition. It's defined 17 different ways by 16 different people. So maybe we should abandon populism as a concept. Right. And I think you are in a very good position to do that. I think the people who study it from an ideational point of view are not very good position to do that, but you are, because illiberal democracy can be adopted instead of populism, and it works. So why not?
I use that as a synonym. I mean, I said that in my book. I mean, I use those two as synonymous. That is easy. Of course, there is a little problem there. That illiberalism democracy, again, is of two kinds. And people do not understand that very easily or immediately, or they cannot go that far because they don't care. Because democratic liberalism, I mean, you know, that article that Farid Zakaria wrote many, many years ago, back in 1970, yeah. And he talked about liberal democracy. So in that very seminal article, because Zakaria is a fascinating thinker, he was a student of Huntington, he knows his stuff. But he never talks about populism in that article, and he never mentions any cases of populism. He mentions cases like Haiti and Bangladesh and Sierra Leone and Romania under Ceausescu at that time, et cetera, et cetera. Now, are those cases populist? No, they're not. Are those democratic liberal cases? Yes, they are. But it is a particular kind of old democratic liberal cases which have never experienced liberalism. Now, that is a defining characteristic. Now, and we have another subtype of democratic liberalism, what we call populism, that is modern democracies that have experienced liberalism in the past, and they go now against that. They have forces, populist parties like your country, my country, which have a tradition of liberalism, okay, unlike Haiti, Sierra Leone, and all of those places, or Bangladesh that I mentioned earlier, okay, that are in which populism is a post-liberal phenomenon. And that is the real puzzle here. I mean, how come, okay, that the populist party may win over already established liberalism? That is my real puzzle. So I can use, you know, populism and democratic liberalism in the same manner as synonymous, and that's fine with me. I do that occasionally. But what I'm trying to understand, okay, that is the real, you know, theoretical puzzle which I'm trying to solve, is how illiberalism may win over liberalism in the modern, in our modern societies. So I don't care about those cases in Africa, in Bangladesh, etc., etc. I care about Hungary, about Finland, about the United States, about France, Greece, etc.
So So, well, thank you very much for joining us, and thank you for the conversation.
It was a pleasure. Thanks. Great questions.
Bye, everybody.